Good morning, everyone. My name is Lacey Adams. I am the Director of Lifespan Faith Development here at Heritage. Reverend Bill Gupton and I will be leading worship today. We are so glad to have you here at this Christmas Eve service. You should not confuse this morning's Christmas Eve service for this evening's Christmas Eve candlelight service. Yes, you are right. You heard me correct. There are two worship services today. You are at the first one. The second one is at 7 p.m. tonight, back right where you are. It is also available by way of Zoom. So if you can't be with us in the sanctuary, you can certainly join us virtually in that way as well. Now, as you might know, parking is limited. So come early so that you can get a good spot. And a second event I want to highlight for you in the coming week is the poetry reading that and workshop this coming Thursday. So we are so excited to have former church member Erica Minton Reed returning to Heritage for the poetry reading. And we would love to see all of you here for the reading and the workshop. If you want more information about any of these things or any of the fine things that we do here at Heritage as a community, they are available to you on the back of your order of service. Now, I hope that you are ready for a bit of fun and excitement and frivolity as we start our Christmas Eve service. Be ready for a bit of singing, a bit of readings, an exciting time for us to be all together. In order to make sure that that happens well, I do want to ask you to make sure that you turn your cell phone onto airplane mode. That makes sure that our technology works well, and it also makes sure that we don't have any ding, 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 dings happening in the course of our worship service that are not appropriate to our hymn singing. Who is the board greeter this morning? There we go. If you happen to be a visitor here, a very hearty welcome on this Christmas Eve. Julie Kane is our board greeter. If you have questions, would like to see our any parts of our building, if you just would like to connect with a person, please make sure that you connect with Julie or one of the beautiful faces surrounding you. With that, let's turn our worship service over to our senior minister, Reverend Bill Gupton.
The call to worship this morning is from Gretchen Haley. Calling all who cannot wait any longer for joy, for hope, for some good news, even a little. The time has come. The waiting is over. Here in this time, we have an old story to tell, one that has been shared over and over for thousands of years, yet somehow still remains unheard, still radical and risky. Breaking through into these days of darkness, division, and fear, interrupting the perpetual stories of violence and loss and feelings of powerlessness. Into the errands and errors of our everyday, Christmas arrives not only to comfort, but to awaken, to reassure, but also to stir us up as if part of a new life, a life of peace and justice and courageous love, all of it struggling to be born. We wonder if we will yet be the ones who finally make room in our lives and in our world for the refugee, the poor, the plain and messy sweetness of a newborn baby, if we will take the journey to Bethlehem, if we will be changed by the presence of a love that meets us where we are, in the fields, wherever we lay, a love that calls us forth on a new journey, a braver and bolder life, believing that it is not too late for strong and gentle people to prevail, not too late for compassion and truth to have the last word, not too late for the bright light of hope to shine through even on the darkest of days. Come, let us celebrate the good news of Christmas this morning. Come, let us worship together. So let's get started this Christmas Eve morning by singing Jingle Bells. The words will appear before you as if you need them. Please rise in body and or spirit and get ready to have some fun. Jingle Bells. Don't sit down. Don't sit down. There's a covenant up there, but we're not going to do the covenant right now. If you're reading your order of service, you know it's time to greet your neighbors. Ooh, a blast from the past. So it's a holiday. Spread some cheer. Say hello to someone before we do our covenant. You still don't want you to sit down, though. Everyone's wanting to sit down. What is this sitting down? It's Christmas Eve. So now it's time for the covenant. Was that kind of that? We haven't done that since BC, before COVID. Greet your neighbors. By this covenant, we affirm that love is the spirit of this church. The quest for truth. Now, if you're in the sanctuary, you may be seated. If you're on Zoom, you probably stayed seated the whole time. Wait, hi, Zoom. We love you. And so it is Christmas Eve. The young among us, and remember that's not always defined by chronology, are bursting with anticipation. For some, it's about the gifts and the goodies. For others, it's about the gathering together of friends and family. For still others, there's something about Christmas Eve here in this sanctuary that brings special meaning to both this morning and this evening. Many memories fill our minds, the hopes and fears of all the years, that kind of thing. Because Christmas, one must admit, is a hodgepodge of feelings. It is both a frenzy of activities and a time of slowing down. In other words, just about everything comes wrapped up in this holiday like the much maligned fruitcake, or maybe better yet, a nice warm pot pie. Therefore, as we begin our morning service this Christmas Eve, a service that itself will include a little bit of everything, I offer you divergent thoughts about Christmas from two of my favorite colleagues, the Reverend Aaron Payson and the Reverend Kendall Gibbons. Aaron writes this: "Can it be that yet another year has passed? Wasn't it just yesterday that we heard the familiar music, that the well-worn stories awakened us from our post-harvest slumber? Wasn't it only weeks ago that we last reminisced about seasons past, when life seemed easier or more innocent or somehow lighter? Didn't we converse then about how much there was still left to do and how short the daylight hours had become? Wasn't it we who sat together then and sipped warm cider or perhaps hot chocolate, laughing as we shared again the memories of youth that still somehow in a Christmas miracle continue to gleam from our eyes? Or was it just coffee and conversation about a world gone mad? And hadn't we just made the promise that a year hence, we'd be further along than we were, and far more accomplished in the doing, those perpetually elusive resolutions proving us kindred in effort and siblings in spirit, if nothing else? Oh, how can it be that we are here again? It is incredible. It is miraculous. How excellent. Let us then give thanks for this heartfelt return. You who have been so much a part of each other's lives, whose presence is synonymous with joy and love, you who are yourselves such a gift. Huzzah! Let old stories be shared again with new insight and new adventures add spice to the routines of our existence. Let life's milestones mark for us the path forward to possibilities yet imagined. For the world, with its many challenges, is needful of this, of communities like ours, of people who speak of memory and hope with love deep enough to speak truth to power, with humility rich enough to make us mindful of the privileges we have not yet earned, and with a conscience broad enough to demand those rights be accorded to all people. Today, this year, let the light in our eyes speak with the awakening that it is ours to embody. For the truth that we seek is the life we lead, and the love we share is the essence of that peace for which we yearn." Thank you, Brother Aaron. And now for some Christmas ruminations to challenge you and perhaps offer a different perspective on this holiday from the Reverend Kendall Gibbons. "One of the great things about Christmas," she says, "is that it is a sturdy holiday. Christmas doesn't wimp out when times are hard. It comes anyway, even if there are hardly any presents, even when there isn't much food to make a feast with, even if you're sad, even if the world around you is at war, as it is. Even if you're living in fear and danger and oppression, Christmas still comes. And here is its secret, the thing most of us haven't considered. When Christmas comes, as it does every year, Christmas is subversive. Christmas, with its story of an unwed mother and a doubtful father, with its legend of a helpless baby born in a stable, who was worshipped by some of the wisest and richest men in the world, with its tale of a child pursued by the deadly wrath of kings who escaped to a foreign land and was a refugee. Christmas, with its ancient, enduring summons of peace on earth, goodwill to all people, everywhere. You just can't stop a day like that with a little hardship or greed or injustice. It will show up anyway, shining the light of a midnight star into even the darkest places of our collective lives. So do not underestimate the power of a manger and the hope it holds. The Christmas song of the angels is not as innocent as it sounds. It has turned the world upside down before. It still can. Amen, Sister Kendall. Amen. So now let us welcome Christmas. Let us allow our spirits to rise along with our bodies, and let us sing together a quiet hymn, number 224, Let Christmas Come.
So now y'all are a little shell-shocked. You're like, oh, no, I'm just going to stand. I'm not going to sit because someone's going to tell me I've done that wrong. So, as many of you know, I am Cajun. And despite the fact that Em and I are raising our children Jewish, we are also trying to raise them Cajun. Ben, for a long time, would have said that he was the, quote, tiniest Cajun Jew, which was true until recently. Someone has usurped him in that title, so we now just say that he is a tiny Cajun Jew. The reason I say that is to highlight, I think, an important truth about Christmas. There isn't one way of doing Christmas. There isn't one way of having Christmas. And there isn't one way of celebrating Christmas. And they know this because I did not grow up in a home that had a Santa Claus, so this is changing culturally. I did not grow up in a family that had Santa because Cajuns have Papa Noel, which is just a Cajun version on some level of the St. Nicholas myth. Sometimes Papa Noel is St. Nick, and sometimes he is Papa Noel. And so when we tell the story of St. Nick, it is this, in a particularly Cajun way, where Papa Noel is dressed in muskrat. ethnic cultures, specific ethnic cultures, our version of Christmas functions a little differently. So I thought that a great thing to do on this morning, this Christmas morning, this Christmas Eve morning, would be to share with you a tradition that we have in our family, and that is the reading of 'Twas the Night Before Cajun Christmas, to expose you all to the story of Papa Noel. And in my practicing, I came upon, because Cajun is not a written language, right? So Cajun French speakers, it is not written. Cajun French is not written. It's a completely oral language. So when Cajun words get written, they're sort of based upon this strange pronunciation. And when you read them, or even when you read the English versions of Cajun versions of words, it's just so you know how to pronounce it. It's never so it can be read. So it makes writing Cajun books complicated, right? When I was practicing, I was like, oh, I need to find a video to make sure that I am pronouncing these words correctly. But in finding the video, I found that the publisher of the Cajun Night Before Christmas, right before Christmas Eve, drops a video of the book. And thanks to Kevin was gracious enough to drop that video into our worship slideshow for us. So instead of hearing me tell the story, we are actually going to hear, we're going to see a short video of the Cajun Night Before Christmas put out by the publisher of that book.
'Twas the night before Christmas, and all through the house, there don't a thing pass, not even a mouse. The children be nestled good snug on the floor, and Mama passed the pepper through the crack on the door. Then Mama in the fireplace done roast up the ham, stir up the gumbo, and make bake the yam. Then out on the bayou, they got such a clatter, make sound like a burro done fall off his ladder. I run like a rabbit to got to the door, trip over the dog, and fall on the floor. As I look out the door, in the light of the moon, I think, man, you crazy, or done got old too soon. 'Cause there on the bayou, when I stretch my neck stiff, there's an alligator, a pulling a skiff. And a little fat drover with a long pulling stick, I know right away, got the be old Saint Nick. More faster and faster the gator they came, he whistled and hollered and called them by name. Ha Gaston, ha Thibault, ha Pierre, now say, Jean Nanette, G Susette, Celeste and Renee. To the top of the porch, to the top of the wall, make crawl, alligator, and be sure you don't fall. Like Taint Flo's cat, through the treetop he fly, when them big old hound dog come a run himself by, like that of the porch, them all get a climb, with the skiff full of tar and St. Nicholas behind. Then on top the porch roof, it sound like the hail, when all them big gator done sat down their tail. Then down the chimney, I yell with a bam, and St. Nicholas fall and sit on the yam. Sacre, he exclaimed, my pant got a hole, I done sat myself on them red hot coal. He got on his foot and jumped like a cat out to the floor where he land with a splat. He was dressed in muskrat from his head to his foot, and his clothes is all dirty with ashes and soot. A sack full of plaything he threw on his back, he looked like a burglar, and that's for a fact. His eyes, how they shine, his dimple, how merry. Maybe he been drink the wine from blackberry. His cheek was like rose, his nose like a cherry. On second thought, maybe, he lap up the sherry. With snow-white chin whisker and quivering belly, he shook when he laughed like them strawberry jelly. But a wink in his eye and a shook o' his head make my confidence that I don't got to be scared. He don't do no talking, gone straight to his work, put plaything in sock, and then turn with a jerk. He put both his hand there on top of his head, cast a eye on that chimney, and then he done said, with all of that fire and them burning hot flame, me, I ain't going back by that way that I came. So he run out the door and climbed to the roof. He ain't no fool, him, to made one more goof. He jump in his skiff and crack his big whip. The gator moved down and done made one slip. And I hear him shout loud as a splashing he go, Merry Christmas to all till I saw you some more.
Thank you, Lacey. That was very, very cool. I did not know what was coming, and I loved it. I hope you did too. So let's get up. Let's sing again. Are your halls decked? Yes? Well, are you ready to greet Papa Noel?
Yes.
Or Santa? Papa Noel sounds more fun. Deck the Halls is our next carol. It's number 235 if you care about a hymnal, or just fa-la-la-la-la along on the wall.
Thank you.
Every year is different, right? We have to be heedless of the weather in a different way this year. We have to pretend it's not 60 degrees as we slip into Christmas. As we have a number of guests and visitors with us this morning, I should point out that each week Heritage Universalist Church does something rather unique, rather uncommon among contemporary houses of worship. Yes, we pass a plate, and yes, we collect an offering, but we don't collect that money for ourselves. And we don't put that offering toward our needs, toward the heating bill, toward the bank payments, or staff salaries, or even the coffee that's out in the Great Hall. No, every Sunday, every week, throughout the year, we target a nonprofit organization that is working to make our world a better, safer, more just, and more loving place for everyone. Everyone to live and to thrive. And we call it sharing our abundance because that is exactly what we're doing. Each of us takes from our abundance and offers something to the offering plate and to the group that we are supporting during that week. This holiday week, we are supporting the Ronald McDonald House of Cincinnati. Now, those of you who've been here at least 16 years, and let's see who you are. Been here 16 or more years? Okay, so you folks will remember that my family was once the grateful recipient of the loving care and ministry of a Ronald McDonald House. And so Jennifer and I have long been fans and supporters of their mission. In our case, it was the Ronald McDonald House in Norfolk, Virginia, where we lived, our home away from home, with a comfortable bed, a kitchen to cook in, a dining room to eat in, a living room to relax in when that was possible, while our then 11-year-old son Patrick was hospitalized right across the street at the Children's Hospital of the King's Daughters, recuperating from a very specialized surgery that we had to travel hundreds of miles for him to receive. And this is a story of so many families throughout the year, not just at this time of year, who need medical care for their children. This is where Ronald McDonald Houses come in. All over the country, they have converted homes that are adjacent to children's hospitals into homes away from home for families who can stay there as their kids face difficult, often life-threatening illnesses or surgeries, where they face medical issues and complications, and hopefully where they recover and recuperate. Not on the timetable of the insurance company, but on the timetable of their own health and their own body. Ronald McDonald House of Cincinnati is right across the street from Children's Hospital. In my capacity as your minister, I've visited many of our children when they have been hospitalized there. I often drive past the Ronald McDonald House, and I can tell you that I get a special feeling of warmth and comfort whenever I see that house, even though that's not the one we stayed at. They are connected. And I know that there are families there in that house at any given time who, unlike if you're here in town and you can come back to your own home in your own bed when your child is in the hospital, if you're so inclined, those people are away from home, often hundreds and thousands of miles away from home, and they're scared, they're worried, they're stressed. But whenever they need a nap or a respite or a warm meal, they can just go right across the street to their home away from home, the Ronald McDonald House. That's why I support the Ronald McDonald House, and that's why I hope you will support them as well. This week's Sharing Our Abundance will now be gratefully received. Thank you for your generous support to the Ronald McDonald House of Cincinnati. May their work bring comfort and hope to families in this time of a holiday. And now we diverge a little bit from our published order of service, and I invite you into a time of prayer and reverence with words not from Rebecca Parker, but rather these words written by Carter Smith. Spirit of life, in this Christmas season, on this Christmas Eve, may we bear witness to the guiding lights that now and have always surrounded us. The lights in the sky that call us to gather and to give of ourselves, that call us to celebrate new life. May we receive and offer glad tidings, the good news that life and its seasons continue on unchecked and undaunted, that tyrannical rulers do not have the final word, that despair and disillusionment are not everlasting. May our senses be awakened to delight in the gifts of fragrance and warmth, to savor the feasts before us, and to revel in the joy and warmth of friendly embraces. May we breathe deeply as we sit with the quiet stillness of these short days, and may our hearts beat to a rhythm of gladness as we lift our voices to proclaim the joy of this season. May it be so, and amen. Perhaps you come this morning in need of a quiet time amid this busy season. Perhaps peace awaits as near as the next breath. I invite you to take this time now to offer yourself a Christmas gift, a time of quiet, of prayer, and of reflection. May the Christmas spirit abide in each and every heart. Amen.
As Christmas holds all of our joys and our sorrows, our feelings of complexity, our feelings of celebration, so it is with our community, and that we together celebrate those and hold them together in our candles of community. So we are invited now to, we're gonna share candles that have been pre-submitted first, as so you can have a moment to gather on the outside row, so you may come forward, take the microphone, share your name and your candle of joy or sorrow with us, and Reverend Bill will light them. First, we do have a few pre-submitted candles. And for those of you who are on Zoom, if you have a candle that you would like to share with us, now would be the opportunity to put those in the chat, and we will share them collectively as well. So first, and then we will light one last candle for our unspoken joys and sorrows this week.
So I think perhaps we could use a little caroling now. Something silly and fun and frivolous. So I invite you to feel the Christmas spirit welling up in you so much that it perhaps lifts you to your feet if you are able. And let's sing together, carol together these next two carols, beginning with We Wish You a Merry Christmas and then Frosty the Snowman.
We wish you a Merry Christmas, we wish you a Merry Christmas.
As I said earlier, this season is a unique time of year, a time for both silliness and fun, as well as for deep reflection on how we might do better in the year ahead, how we might help to make the world a better place and to bring the dream to life. It is okay, it is right that Christmas has both these energies and all these emotions. Christmas invites us to engage with an old story, a legend, a myth, an aspiration, and to see it with new eyes, just as we see each new Christmas Eve, both with the eyes of experience and with the eyes of innocence, to paraphrase William Blake. So I'd like to share with you a Facebook post that I saw this week, written by Scott Erickson. It is assumed that Mary rode on a donkey, but the Bible doesn't say she did. It is assumed that there was an innkeeper, but one is not mentioned in the story. It is assumed that there were three magi, but no number is given in the scripture. It is assumed that there was a star overhead when Jesus was born, but it doesn't say that either. It's assumed the baby was born in a stable, but all it really says is that he was laid in a manger, and that could have been any number of places. The point is that Christmas comes with a lot of assumptions, some helpful, some not so much. Spirituality also comes with assumptions, and they fail us when they make it about what things are supposed to look like, who is worthy for something to happen to, what kind of outcome is supposed to occur. Such assumptions actually hinder us on our spiritual journey, and so there's an antidote to assumption. It's called surprise. It is a surprise when life comes from barren places. It is a surprise that meek nobodies can be part of divine plans. It's a surprise that messengers are sent all along our mundane journey of life, all the better to let us know that we are not alone. It is a surprise that you will be given, have been given, everything you need to accomplish what you have been asked to do. It's a surprise that nothing can separate you from the love of God. That's right, nothing can separate you from love. Your assumptions tell you that there must be something that can do that. But surprise, nothing can. Merry Christmas. May this season be a reminder of that surprising truth for us, and may this church also be a reminder for you of that truth. So let's sing once more, this time a familiar carol that also happens to be a hymn called It Came Upon the Midnight Clear. Sherry, please play for us, and everyone else, please rise as the Spirit moves you and join me in singing It Came Upon the Midnight Clear.
Thank you.
Friends, as I look at the clock on the back wall of the sanctuary, I see it says 11:28, which means to me that on the tiny island of Lombok in Indonesia, in the Pacific Ocean, right now, it is 28 minutes after midnight. Christmas has come, where our son Patrick is right now. I remember when Patrick was young, on Christmas Eve, we would follow Santa's progress around the globe on a special website offered by NORAD. Christmas, like New Year's Day and every other day, comes first in the South and West Pacific, places where our son now spends a lot of time. So, in honor of the fact that Santa has begun his journey, I know the alligators in Louisiana still await for Papa Noel, but Santa's begun his journey around the world, it might behoove us to offer some encouragement to those reindeer, because it's still a long way to Cincinnati. Let's sing about everybody's favorite reindeer, Rudolph. So I see you guys kind of do the descant, so to speak, on some of these regular Christmas carols that we only get to sing every few years. I'm glad we were able to do that today. There will be choir descanting tonight at 7. Please be here for that. And now as our service on this morning of Christmas Eve draws to a close, I offer you some final thoughts on perfection, preparedness, and the potential that is inherent in this holiday and in this season from the Reverend Maureen Killoran. No one is ever really ready for Christmas. If we were really prepared, if every gift had been completely contemplated and had been obtained, if every present was beautifully beribboned, if all the goodies that our friends deserve were already baked and cooled and stored just so, if each and every person we love was gathered for our celebration, and if we never, ever snapped at someone we care about or fell short of being all that we could be, if our minds were 100% loving and our hearts were 100% generous, then we might truly be ready for Christmas. But of course, then we wouldn't really need Christmas to come. So come, Christmas, you most needed of seasons. Come with the reminder that love does not depend on perfection, but rather on our willingness to risk connection. Come, Christmas, come into the unready manger of our hearts so that we might feel the warmth of new life and give flesh to the promise of hope that cries out, seeking to bring healing and love into our world. Come Christmas, come love, come hope. Be born this day and this night in our unready hearts. It is Christmas Eve, my friends, which can only mean one thing. I hope I will see you all again tonight at 7 o'clock. Here in what will be at first a dimly lit sanctuary, but one that will ultimately be filled with candlelight and beautiful music and an ancient story that still touches unready hearts. Until then, or in case I don't see you tonight, have yourself a merry little Christmas. Now let's sing our closing hymn. Take it away, Sherry.
Have yourself a merry little Christmas. Let your heart be light. From now on, your troubles will be out of sight. Have yourself a merry little Christmas. Make the Yuletide gay. From now on, your troubles will be miles away.
Perhaps around the front half of the sanctuary for the benediction. May the spirit of life,
may the spirit of life
that each of us possesses,
that each of us possesses,
flow from one to the other,
flow from one to the other.
May it stay with us,
may it stay with us,
and bring us peace and harmony,
and bring us peace and harmony,
until we meet again,
until we meet again.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Cake and coffee in the Great Hall.